You just heard Rose Mary Harbison play the violin solo Meditation from the opera Thais by Massenet. We thought the sound of Rose Mary's magnificent instrument would set the mood for this unusual event. She is playing a Sanctus Serafino, made in 1737 and considered to be a uniquely beautiful instrument, both in its voice and its physical appearance. It is from the time of the so-called Golden Age of Violins, which is the theme of tonight's program. Jack Fry and Rosie Harbison worked together as a team to explore and research the acoustics of these treasured instruments. The height of this period was 1650 to 1750. Antonio Stradivari has come to represent the highest level of quality in these instruments, but many other makers, less famous, created instruments equally prized and possessing the same elements that are so admired in strads, as they are called. Jack Fry is a high-energy physicist and violin builder who is engaged in researching, identifying, and presenting the facts behind this ideal of violin sound. He has worked in partnership with Rose Mary for more than 25 years in this quest. She serves as sounding board, demonstrator, commentator, and collaborator. And in 2006, Jack was elected membership in the Galileo Academy of Padova for his contributions to high energy physics and violin research. We are thrilled to have them both with us tonight to explore the magical sound of the Golden Age violins. And I will now like to turn the program over to Rose Mary Harbison.
I'm going to use notes. Me. I want to talk to you about the parts of the violin because in one of the evening, in one of the pre-rehearsals here, one of these wonderful people was confused by the horse here and the bow. So we're going to talk about what the parts of this are externally. Jack will talk about what's on the inside. This is the scroll, this part. In the scroll are pegs to hold the strings, which come across the instrument on the neck and arrive at a bridge, and then which becomes finally a tailpiece that's pegged into the end of the violin. This is a chin rest, and this is my sponge pad for keeping the violin somewhere in the vicinity of my shoulder. It's from Walgreens, in case you need one. Really high tech. The violin is tuned in four pitches, E, which is above 440A, there's 440A, D, and G. And these strings all have a different viscosity, and I'm going to play a little bit before this program starts in order to show you some aspects of how it responds when I play slow and what happens when I play fast. But I'm going to talk first. I'm going to first of all lay the violin down. Jack, you don't mind if I lay them all on your tools, do you? No. A friend of ours once said about Jack's tools, he could get it in any car in the business. I don't tell anybody that. Let me just talk about the primary sonic aspects of the violin. The unique thing is that this object is 14 inches long, and you can hear it in a hall that has 5,000 people sitting in it. You should ask yourself why. It projects. It has dynamic range. Dynamic means loud and soft. It has responsive, a good violin, I should say, the primary elements of fine violins is what I'm talking about, should have tremendous dynamic range, responsive to bow pressure, whether it's light or strong, speed, have fast pitch response, and have an even response across the four strings. And that I'm going to talk about when I play a bit of the partita of Bach of E major. Because when you're doing something and you're really at a very fast tempo, you realize that if the strings if the instrument isn't balanced correctly, you can't get past the difference between these strings. They're thicker, the G is thicker than the D, than the A, than the E, and it can create a discontinuity. The ideal tone quality, and this is somewhat obviously my sensibility, but I think there's some truth to this, should be very focused. The sound of this tone should have a beautiful center, very simple, and it should also be very identified where it is. And in that sound, you should hear other elements around it, which I call the aura. It's not, if the A is a little lesser, this is a B. You can hear, so you can hear other sounds around it, yes? I guess it's being amplified. I'm sorry about that, kids. That's okay. It has a singing quality like the voice, and it has a ringing element, which is the mark of a very fine instrument, is when you let the bow up and you lighten it, it still keeps the what I would call the tessitura of the voice. It keeps the center diamond point of light of that sound. It is also supple in timbre, which means if I want to talk to you with the instrument, and I don't want it to be always the same thing. Yes? Sort of like that. My next one is vibrato. You see people's hand wobbling, right? This is what's happening in slow motion. But without it, with it, not bad, huh? Somebody thought something up. Bow speeds for a change of expressiveness and virtuosity. And I'm going to play just a little bit. You want to turn me off, as it were? This is going to be, I'm just going to play a little bit, and I don't promise it'll be perfect because that's not what we're doing, but that is the beginning of the partita for unaccompanied violin in E major by J.S. Bach, and it starts across the instrument. This is slow. It has dynamics that are in terrace. It doesn't go that slow. Play that perfectly, but what I wanted to show you, this pattern in it. It has three strings involved, and this is thin one, middle, thick. And to get it to not fly into some craziness, the instrument has to speak perfectly. That's a big deal. A lot of violins will do, you can't get them to speak in that consistent response. This is a hard hall to play in because I can't see you and I can't stand up very well. But the other thing I want to show you is in the Brahms concerto, he throws the book in the beginning. And I'm going to play a little bit of it slow. As you can see, what an instrument has to be able to do, and I hope I can, This is the beginning of the piece. It's 49 bars of upbeat before you get the tune, and it is about everything that they ever thought of putting in the piece. Those are octaves. That's not for sissies. And especially not in a dark room. I can't see you, I can't see him. And I didn't start at a tempo, I just, anyway, we'll skip that. You get the idea. There's a lot that happens. You're confronted with a piece with multiple problems right away. And you have to be ready to go, and so does the instrument. The last thing I'm going to play is a demonstration, and I think a lot of you perhaps don't know this, but playing soft and legato is one of the hardest things to do. And the instrument has to have ring. For that to happen. This is a slow movement, a bit of the Sarah band of the D minor partita of Bach. And the important thing is how beautifully it picks up that. I like that. Talking so much easier than playing. When I worked with Jack and how we work, I've learned early on not to judge the instrument. It's hard not to. When he hands me an instrument and he's in the middle of an experiment, I don't like it some of the time. And I was very destructive when I would say, no, that's no good, I don't like it. Turned out I should have kept my mouth shut. Because when it emerged, what he was trying to do, then of course, I did like it, or it was right. So we are always in the process of he is always in the process of investigating particular details of the acoustics of this instrument, and he will talk about that. And my role is to try to give him as accurate a response to what, in fact, is being heard and how it plays. We developed a set of words to describe the components of what we were doing. And some of the words over a period of time, we don't use many of them now because we're at reaching nirvana, I think. Or we're quitting, I don't know which. Some of the words were bright, bitey, shrill, hollow, nasal, boomy, deep, woody, tight, needs cushion, silky, sweet, afterglow, chuff, dry, focus, too loose, yes, no. Words change with various periods, and these are just some of the words. I used to keep a record. I learned, however, along the way, Jack would discover one thing about an instrument. We'd have four violins, he'd do it on all of them. And if it was the wrong move, well, guess what? So I used to get a hold of instruments that I thought were pretty good and hide them and not tell him where they were. And then he would say, oh, something like, well, that wasn't the, I shouldn't have done that. And I would be able to produce a violin that he hadn't done up. It was great. One of the primary things I tried to do throughout was clarify the nature of the center of that sound, because that is where the great instruments are at. It is that center diamond point that has the flexibility around it. And also to discover what, when a player goes into a shop to buy an instrument, they're looking for all kinds of things. They're looking for ease of playing, something that suits them, but they're looking for an instrument that has some personality unto itself, or they ought to be. When I first encountered the Seraphim, I thought this is either the greatest or the worst instrument I've ever heard, and I didn't know which. Well, for about 2 minutes, I didn't. In other words, a great instrument has its own personality, and you have to meet it. But it brings to you a tremendous potential of what you can't even imagine. And Jack has achieved that. And it's pretty exciting. One of the unusual things that emerges, and there are many, but one of them that's interesting, particularly interesting, is that if the violin sounds loud up close when I'm playing it, it probably isn't projecting. If it's quiet, it probably is projecting. And he probably should talk about that. The Seraphim has a tremendous range of color and dynamic. It's a little hard to show it in here. This is a tough acoustic. And besides, I can't see you. It has revealed things that I couldn't have imagined. So let us begin. I introduce my friend and colleague, Jack, a true Renaissance man.
Thank you, Rosie. About 50 years ago or so, something like that, I had a very interesting and, for me, a very important evening. My friend and colleague, Professor Wilson Powell, invited me to dinner and invited me to play duets with him afterwards. And that was really stretching the point, because he was quite a good violinist and I was quite a poor violinist. But he was thoughtful enough to remember that I didn't have a violin, so he went to the music department at the University of California and borrowed two violins, one made by Stradivari and the other by Galliano. And obviously, I had never played an old Italian violin before, and probably in something like 5 minutes, I realized that here was something which was really very dynamically and artistically very different than I had ever experienced before. Being a bit egocentric and certainly very opinionated, I decided right then and there that physics should have something to do with the ability to understand what the differences would be between those great instruments and modern instruments. Little did I know at that time how complicated it was. maybe 10 years later, after maybe 30 experiments and 20 ruined violins, I had not made much progress in trying to improve the sound of the violin. But I did have one strong feeling that indeed the so-called secrets of the old Italian violins was probably not one or two or three single things like varnish and woods and shape, but a complicated mixture of many phenomena which were always interconnected, interrelated, and tied together. This was quite contradictory to my experience in higher geophysics, because in higher geophysics, fundamental particle physics, a lot of progress was made simply because by picking out fundamental things, neglecting other things, simplifying, going from chemistry to atomic physics to nuclear physics to studying the properties of protons, details of the protons, all the way down to the neutrino and electron. But the violin, I became convinced, was a completely different set of complicated phenomena. Now, once I started to think about a few of these complexities, I began to realize that I certainly was not able, because I was not a theorist, and I was not familiar, but I did know that if you have a large number of interrelated phenomena, you can't find the exact solutions. And so I quickly realized that rather than trying to find exact solutions for these problems, I had to take another tack. And that's a common one in physics, physicists who use other fields of activity, and that is you build models. You build models where the model tries to duplicate the essence of the idea, and then by the simplified models, try to understand the correlation between those. So after about another 20 years, I developed a series of models which are really gross oversimplifications, but they had some ways of thinking about the complexity of this problem. And there were perhaps four things that I felt the violin had to solve, some problems that they had to solve. One, they had to read enough sound in the low frequencies, and that is on the G string, 250 some cycles, up to maybe 800 cycles, in the low frequency range where the violin is small compared to the size of the wavelength. And so the violin had to utilize some system to amplify that component of its sound. And I'll talk a little bit about that. The next thing that I realized that the great violins had to solve was they had to get rid of the shrill components of its sound. So somehow or other, you had to control the mechanisms which give rise to shrill sounds. And they are, for instance, in the region from perhaps 1,000 cycles to something like 4,000 or 5,000 hertz. Then perhaps the most important thing about the violin acoustics is that the violin has to radiate with as much energy as possible the very high frequency components of the sound on the vibrating string. Of course, the origin of all the sound is the vibrating string. And the way the bow excites the string, it excites actually all the components which are overtones of the fundamental. Now that is a problem, and as you people all I'm sure know, that if you want to buy a high frequency sound system, there's a component we quite often refer to as the tweeter. And so the violin has to somehow have in its construction a tweeter device, which, as we all know, can't be very heavy, and it needn't be very large because the wavelength of high-frequency sound is actually quite short. The fourth thing that the great violins has to satisfy is that it has to have what we refer to as high-frequency ringing. And that is a phenomenon where a note that is played on, say, the A string can, in its overtone, excite that same overtone frequency on an open string. And so that the coupling between the bowed string and the open string takes energy away from that overtone. And so the ringing changes the timbre of the sound, so that it's important for amplifying the vibrato of where you're changing frequency, but you don't hear that change in frequency. What you're hearing primarily is a change in timbre. So the timbre change amplifies the vibrato. And the other thing is, quite often I would take a violin to Rosie and she'd say, I can't play this fiddle in tune. And I think, she has all the skills to put her fingers down in the right place. What is she meaning? Well, it turns out that the exact coupling of the high frequency overtone, it may be the 10th overtone on the A string, is the same as the 14th on the D string. That same overtone frequency then is excited on the open string, and that changes its timbre. If you play slightly out of tune, that timbre is changed. So you're relying on timbre change to tell you the frequency which is correct. Of course, that assumes the violin's tuned correctly. All right, so let me talk about these various aspects. First, let me talk about the radiation of low frequency. And the violin, because it's about so size and the wavelengths are about this long, it utilizes a very clever trick to increase the radiation in the low frequencies. And it is a motion of the top and back plate, which I call the breathing mode. And I will just simply say that the violin utilizes the motion in the opposite direction of the top and the back. There is a bass bar underlying the left side of the violin, and it goes from about here to down there. It rests, it is underneath the left foot of the violin bridge. On the right side is a post which is wedged in between the top and the back. The motion of this right foot makes the back move. It's basically a driven system, not a resonating system. And so when the string goes to the left, your right, this foot will go down and this will come up. And that results in the fact that the motion of the top and the back are out of phase. They do this sort of thing. So when the string is going back and forth, the box is doing that. And this displacement of the plates sucks air in and out through the F-holes. And the velocity of air through the F-hole is very large compared to the velocity of air on the surface of the plate. And because of that increase in velocity, there's an increase in radiation. It's actually a much more complicated system than that, but that's the basic emphasis. It resulted in an idea which came early, namely that if you want to study the motion of the back and try to think of making the back act like a piston, there is an interesting problem in that the sound post does not lie at the geometrical center of the back. It lies below it and to the right. If indeed that were the conditions of driving a uniform plate, then that black plate would rock sideways and up and down. And what you want to get maximum air displacement is a piston-like motion. The net result of that is the fact that the thickness of the back plate is not uniform. And I should say that one of the main factors that you have as a violin maker in controlling the way a plate moves is its thickness. Why? Because the stiffness of a plate or the stiffness of a region depends upon the cube of the thickness. In other words, if you make a small change in thickness, you make a big change in stiffness. Therefore, you can control the detailed stiffness of that back plate by how you change the shape of the graduations, the thickness control. So that was an idea which I developed some years ago, and I told my friend Wilson Powell about it. And I said to Wilson, you know, if it is an important factor, probably the Italians knew about it. And it would be nice to see if indeed they solved this problem by making an asymmetry in the thickness graduation of the back. So, for example, let's take a little segment out of the back like that. This area is long and it's far away. This is short and nearby. So the thickness here, let's call that the thickness to the right and the thickness to the left. This difference in thickness can compensate for the difference in distance and the differences in length. So this should be thin and that should be thick. And we were having a beer one evening, and Wilson said, you know, since you told me about that, I've thought of a way that we could measure this in the Italian instruments. And I was very grateful because I wasn't going to take the top off of a Strad and maybe do damage to a $5 million instrument. And he came up with a very simple idea, and this was a typical Wilson. He was very clever in this regard. Incidentally, he was an expert in magnets and built the magnet system for the atomic accelerator in Oak Ridge. But anyway, that's another story. He said, well, look, all I did was, and I tried this out the other night, I got myself a postage stamp scale and a little magnet and weakened the magnet such that I could drop a little magnet inside the violin and find out where that is below, put a magnet on the postage stamp scale and pull them apart, and the place where they break is related to the thickness. And he had a piece of wood he'd calibrated in the thickness and showed that, that indeed that would work. And he spent the next 10 years of his life going around the world measuring very famous Italian violins. But he quickly found that indeed most of all the great Italian violins did have asymmetries in it, and they were about what you might expect from this sophomore physics idea, and in fact in the right direction. Namely, they're thinner here than they are there. But of course, you know, most people don't worry about that asymmetry. They worry about the asymmetry here and the thickness there. Well, it turns out there's still a difference, but it's quite small. For example, this may be 2.3 millimeters, and this should be about 2.6, 2/10 or 3/10 of a millimeter. That's very small. And that's probably the reason that no one has really, before that, realized that the asymmetries were there in the Italian instruments. Now, to make the story more complicated, you don't want the back to move like a piston. In fact, you want it to involve both of the other modes, a rocking mode this way, but a twisting mode that way. So the result is, by controlling the graduation of the back plate, you can get the right amplitudes of those motions. And this is a typical graduation that we found and I quite often use in instruments. The asymmetry is small, but notice this is thinner than it is here by a small amount. And this lies over here compared to that. This is bigger than there, and so on. The next problem is how do you control the shrillness of the violin? Now, for frequencies of the shrill region of the violin, the size of the violin is perfect for radiation of those frequencies of 1,000 hertz. How do you suppress it, and what causes it to happen? Well, let me try to make that as short as I can. Here is the top. This is the bass bar. And this is what I call the soundpost fibers. Let me back up a minute. Woods are complicated. They're complicated because woods of the same type still have differences in their stiffness. And in fact, differences of the stiffness of a wood like spruce may be something as big as 10% from one log to another. But more importantly, woods have a very large asymmetry built into them. Namely, along the direction of the grains, the wood is very stiff to flex that way. But if you flex it sideways, it is much less stiff. And the ratio of those two, which is the ratio of Young's moduli for engineers, is a factor of 12 to 15. One of the things that varnish does for the acoustics of the violin is to change that ratio. And typically, it may change it from, say, 12 to 15 to 9 or 8 or 7, something like that. Major changes. So in a certain sense, you do have a little bit of control in this ratio of asymmetries by the way you varnish it, whether you put in one coat directly after another before it hardens so it can soak into the wood and so on. Now, so the woods are very strong in one direction and weak in the other direction. And this permits you to think about the motions of internal properties of the plate in terms of fibers. Because the fibers here are only loosely connected to the fibers nearby, while as they're stiff along it. So it is correct and useful to think of isolated fibers in the violin. And that is one way to sort of simplify the complication. So in this sketch, I've sketched in the fibers which pass through and above the soundpost. This is the soundpost, which is wedged in between the top and the back. The bridge sits here, slightly in front of the soundpost, so there's a little lever system. And that little lever system means that it drives the fibers this way. Furthermore, the bridge sits closer to the bottom than at the top. So the motion of the left foot of the bridge can make the bass bar rock and therefore radiate sound in the shrill region, just as this little lever system can make the soundpost fibers rock. So the question is, how do you control those things? You can control the rocking motion of the bass bar by the length at each end, which is not necessarily equal. And you can make that different stiffness by the thickness graduations at the end of the bass bar. A more important problem is, how do you control the motion of the soundpost fibers? And here is a very important trick, which I later found out is in most of the Stradivarius violins that I've happened to see. And that is, namely, you make there a strange shape of thickness at the top, and I'll sketch it in. It goes like this, and it goes like that, it goes like this, it goes like that. Another contour of thickness may go like that. This then has a detailed thickness control in it, and this I've called the tongue, simply because it shortens the soundpost fibers, but it also connects the soundpost fibers mechanically to the motion of the bass bar in this upper region. And so this gives additional support to the fibers, which means that the rocking of the fibers near this region is reduced because the fibers are stronger. So this tongue plays many important roles in the acoustics. It can give rise to a very nasal property, which is desirable and is typical of many strads. It gives an increased depth because it drives the back harder. It drives the breathing mode larger. And you can make these coupled in such a way that they tend to counteract each other and reduce the overall motion of the plate in the top region. The next subject, which is perhaps, well, in my opinion, the most important aspect of the violin acoustics, is its high frequency radiation. And for many years, and many lectures, unfortunately, I was completely wrong, because I thought that the radiation probably came from this region around the bridge where most of the action took place. Then I found out by purely experimenting that actually the region which is an effective radiator at very high frequencies is this region right there. Coupled to the region to the right here. But most of all the high frequencies is radiated in that region. What is the advantage of utilizing that small area? So the area I'm talking about, which is by far the most important, is the area that lies to the right of the right F hole, between the edge of the F hole and the edge of the violin, a little area here. Well, it turns out it's easy to make a resonating system so that that system is a resonant system radiating in the region between 6 and 12,000 hertz. How do you do that? So what you do, and it turns out that the measurements of Italian instruments verifies this, the areas of constant thickness, which means stiffness, is centered about a region that's the very top of that F hole. And this area, for example, give you numbers, 3.7 millimeters, which is quite thick for the top of the violin, since in many places it's 2 millimeters. The next contour line will be something like that, and the next contour line goes like that, and the lines like that, and there's a very thin area there, which is about 2.2 millimeters. That means that that point is a fixed point for that oscillator, and the oscillator moves up and down like this. And its resonant frequency is a band of frequencies because the area here varies and from fiber to fiber. So there are some fibers that oscillate at very high frequencies because they're very small in mass and short. Others are longer and heavier. So the high frequency tweeter is that system. Now, there's lots of advantages to that. Namely, the motion of the sound post fibers, which are here, drive adjacent fibers and the series of fibers between the sound post fibers and the edge of the F hole, I call the transfer fibers, simply because they transfer the motion of the sound post fibers to the right. There is a very complicated system here, which I want to spend a few minutes about. It's a high frequency bandpass filter for those interested in technology, and filters out the non-high frequencies, only transmitting the high frequencies into the motion of the streeter. Let me just skim over another subject. There is a conjecture on my part that there is a Stradivarius secret involved in this. In order to effectively transfer the sound post fibers to the adjacent fibers, you would like to have it, the wood strong in its weakest direction. How can you do that? You can do that by employing extra varnish. So possibly, I cannot prove it, but possibly, Stradivari varnished this area several times of transparent varnish until it impregnated that area very highly with varnish, letting it dry, and then varnished the whole violin. And unfortunately, you can't see that. So it could be there. And the experiments show that that really improves the magnitude of the voice of the very high frequency. That's a trick which maybe is true and maybe is not. I will just simply say that this system here, which if you wish, is a heavy mass because it's thick, and down at the end acts like a spring. And so it is a system of a heavy mass and a spring, and that forms a filter which transmits sound and vibration from here over to there for the very highest frequencies. Since the ultimate control of the mechanical and acoustical motion of the plates is in the thickness controlled, it turns out that in this area of the tweeter, a few tenths of a millimeter change makes an enormous difference. Since it is impossible to control all the critical properties of the violin, they are shape, arching, varnish, woods, and so on, you have to have some means to, at the end, compensate for these variations. And I came up with the idea that maybe one way to do that is to somehow scrape on the inside of the violin with a scraper. So I developed a very highly scientific instrument, which consists of a coat hanger, bent, with a little teeny piece of sandpaper on the end. And you can insert this in the F hole and scrape away at the inner surface. And I want to show that we can do this on an instrument, and this will be able to change the acoustical properties. So those coat hangers, which you can show, and actually a much more sophisticated one, namely a coat hanger which is shaped like that. Now, why would I do that? Well, when I get very far from the F hole, it's hard to know where I'm scraping. So I put the lower surface through the F hole and the upper surface above, and that tells me where I'm scraping underneath. And so that's the scientific reason for that. What I would like to do now is to ask Rosie to join me, and we will change the sound of a violin by making very small scrapings in various parts. And I will restrict that to three regions. One, the tongue. The other one, the coupling between the sound post fibers and the tweeter. And the third one, changing the thickness of the tweeter itself. Please join me.
I think we need a little more light.
So we have several violins here. One which I would consider not a very good violin. It's the result of many experiments have been taken apart and put together. But there are parts of it which clearly need to have some changes made in it.
You want some water?
I'm fine. Thank you. So I will first try to make a change by changing the length of the tongue.
He doesn't give me any warning. He just hands me the violin. And I'm kind of,
Now, I must protect myself because sometimes these work and sometimes they don't. I hope this one will be audible. Let me tell you what I would expect. I'm going to shorten the tongue. So I'm going to scrape at the lower end of the tongue by this scraper. And I will think that it makes the lower part a little less nasal. We're in trouble.
All right. Go ahead.
And the effect may not be very big, but I expect you will be able to hear it. So let's hear something.
Well, wait a minute. Let's get some kind of pitch. These instruments don't like I think we're pretty dry in here. Has anybody got a dry meter on them?
Let me tell the story about Rosie and I. I hand Rosie a fiddle, and she says, "Oh, but the bridge is tilted. And it's not the right shape, and the neck's too wide, the nut doesn't fit very well." And I think, come on, Rosie, we're talking about one thing, not the whole fiddle. It's not a concert fiddle. It's a result of an experiment. After I sort of convince her to try to forget those things, then she listens to me and we make changes.
That's what happened.
So she plays lots of things.
I play licks. Licks are just, I make up a bunch of notes, you know? And I try to remember them from one time to the next. Where's it going to affect it? What area?
This is the lower end of the tongue, which is about there.
Yeah.
And I'm going to shorten it, meaning I'll take some scrapes out of here like that. And that will make it so it's a little less nasal.
Less nasal. This is nasal.
So on the D string, for example.
On the G?
D.
John. We have a joke. He's threatening to write a sonata on that
now,
terrible ditty.
I scrape, but the amount of wood I'm taking out is probably hardly visible in dust. But that's simply because the stiffness is so sensitive to change in thickness.
They love how high tech this is. You ready?
Well, how do you say?
It's sweeter. It's still got a lot of nasal stock on it.
Yeah, but
it's a little hollow. It's a tubby.
Let's give it one more scritz and then go on something else. How many could hear the difference? Hey, it
Look
worked.
It's
All
a
right, good.
Good.
These are
You're
educated
B
people.
Plus.
These are educated people. Okay. Incidentally, we go at this sometimes 8 hours a day.
We have a little.
We get lost, but that's all right.
It's ringing better, but this...
Right. I'm not in love with it.
It's also very... it's like somebody sat on the note. I mean, it's the acoustic is really compressed.
Yes, yes.
There's no high.
That's the tweeter. We're going to do it later. One of our problems is, was a problem of Rose and I. I get it in my head that I want to listen to just one thing. And she tells me all sorts of things, you know. Okay. Okay. Let's change the coupling. Now, I'm interested in the transfer of energy from these sound post fibers over the top of the FO over to the tweeter. Should I give them a prediction? That puts me in a bad place. Well, I'll just be quiet.
Wait a minute. Let's hear it. Yeah. And what area?
But listen particularly to the A and E string.
The A and E.
Yeah. What's the problem? Yeah, okay. I won't solve that this time. You're wanting a miracle.
Really thin.
It's thin, right? But most of all, if you start to drive it hard,
it breaks.
The
up.
Note breaks.
That's right. Okay. It doesn't have any cushion.
I will perhaps improve that. You realize I'm taking away a very small amount of wood. Okay.
$1,000
to $1,200.
$1,200, yeah.
Don't make it too good. Oh. Okay. What I would like to do, I would like to try to make the violin more silky. And what I mean by that is, I want to exaggerate the very high frequency part of the violin sound. And possibly reduce the shrill region, but mainly augment the highs. And that's going to have several things. It will tend to soften the violin for you, make it louder for them, but it will also change the timbre, and it will, I hope, increase the ringing slightly.
Mm. Where's this going to happen? I always like to look when it gets interesting.
Here's my
Oops. Yeah, well, this is the problem with these things. Where is it?
Look, here it is. Okay, it didn't drop.
We spent a lot of time crawling around under the piano. Oh, I'm sorry, I ruined the looks.
Experimental physics. Just at the very inner edge of this F hole. Okay. Oh, should be brighter.
Yeah. You know, remember I told you when I played that, it's because it speaks immediately and smoothly, right? We're up to at least 3,000.
Okay. I'll take it.
One thing that is a mark of an instrument is it starts to respond. You start to be able to do a fast passage.
And listen to the ringing.
Should be shot for that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I like it.
Well, it's pretty tight up there.
Yeah.
I can't.
Well, the purpose is not to make a great fiddle now. It's to illustrate the fact that the thickness controls is the key to the understanding of how to control various aspects. I've only touched on a few. It's much more complicated. Thank you. I'd like to turn to one other subject, namely one that I have thought a lot about and is completely my opinion and conjecture. How did the Italians solve the problem? Some say they weren't complicated by having to worry about physics, but my feeling is that, first of all, I'm convinced they did scraping. Why? Because in the museum of Stradivari in Cremona, there is a tool which looks like a scraper. And it would go through the airfoil and permit scraping. And that refers me to a short paragraph read on the book written about Stradivari by Hill, who says that the work of Stradivari is tremendously impressive in terms of its external beauty. But if you look at the inside is not uniform in thickness. In fact, it's not finished terribly well, as if it had been scraped. And that proves the fact that the graduations are, have nothing to do with the sound.
Oh, is that what it says?
Whoops. Well, I couldn't think he's wronger, but that's okay. So I think, how did they solve the problems? Well, first of all, you have to remember that the development of the violin developed over at least 200 years with a large number of people in a chain of teacher-pupil relationship. And furthermore, the fundamental thoughts about understanding the acoustics depend upon basically three things. Stiffnesses of wood, which you can feel. The mass, and although these were not codified at that time in terms of writing down the mathematical relationship, everybody knows that if something is heavy, it's hard to move. And if you want to move it fast, it's got to be light. So the inertial properties of mass, I'm sure they understood. Furthermore, I'm convinced that they understood levers. And you know, I'm sure everyone here has either had their child on a teeter-totter or have sat on a teeter-totter. And everybody knows how a teeter-totter works. They don't have to solve tensor problems. They don't have to solve inertial detail problems. But everybody knows if you have a heavy friend, don't put him far away. And it is these things which could have led them to thinking about the lever system, what affects the tweeter. The tweeters have the right mass. The lever system has the right thickness in the right place. The fact of stiffening the tongue, the sound post fibers by the tongue, is a matter of just thinking about inertial properties. There's one other thing which I should say, it's a little bit out of context, but namely, the bass bar, although it's a very heavy piece of wood, an I-beam, for years I said nonsense about it because I thought it was just a straight I-beam. Well, it turns out that the high frequency propagation sound down the bass bar gives it a property of having an internal oscillator which rocks this way. And that very much affects the support of the high frequency system. And they must have understood that because the property of the bass bar, as you might first think, is determined by the way you carve the bass bar. But the thing that controls the high frequency oscillation of the bass bar is the thickness control of the plate near the bass bar. Because that is a more important factor in moments of inertia and stiffness than the bass bar itself. And lo and behold, the thickness properties of those Italian instruments are at the thin place where you expect an antinode, a thick place where you expect a note. So if you put it in a different bass bar, it still will have the properties of the high frequency resonance.
So there.
Okay.
Are we done?
No, you need to.
We have a little game now. Yeah. We have audience participation time. And no, you don't get to keep it if you win it. We're going to do a little fun thing. There's an instrument, you know, this is a seraphim, and it's still in tune. And this is a current violin of Jack's called the Audrey, for his dearly beloved wife sitting here, the Audrey, which he threw into the trash and he got out.
It's even better story than that, but that's all right. Incidentally, the violin's been taken apart, regraduated, and all the ideas put into it.
It's hard for fiddles to sit around in this kind of... Okay, you come here, Jack. I'm going to play, again, our favorite meditation, but I'm going to change instruments at every other phrase, and you're going to tell me which one I'm playing. First, we're going to turn around and church.
We'll shovel them.
Okay.
Number one. Number two.
This wants us a bit. This violin wants the bow to be less tight. Let me just demonstrate a little bit of why I'm in. This violin, and then we're going to say which. This is number two.
Number two.
No, this is. Oh, I'm mixed up. I won't know what we've got up here. Okay, kids. Number two and number one. Which is a seraphim? Two or one?
Two. Why don't you clap? Those who think number one is the seraphim, clap. Those who think number two is the seraphim, clap. They're good and clever.
They're good. Yeah. You were right.
That's correct.
But you.
What? It's a Walgreens bun.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you something. It's hard to just play back and forth. That Audrey is a really marvelous instrument. Absolutely can do anything I want it to do. But we're done. You've been great.
Thank you.
charge to let you ask questions. Oops. Yes.
No.
Wait. We have somebody coming. He's down here.
Sorry.
It is said that a violin has to be played to sound. It is said that a violin has to be played a lot to sound good.
Is there any truth to that?
Yes.
Is there a physics reason for it?
I was hoping somebody would ask that question. I didn't pay him. Yes, there is a very well understood phenomenon now. Varnishes are a polymer. Polymers made of little teeny small fibers in a liquid. When the liquid hardens, the fibers bind at the point where they're in contact. If you stress that, you break some of the bonds and you change then the stiffness, but you also change the energy loss. By playing the violin, you do cause these fibers to break to some extent. And what that does, it generally makes the plates left stiff. Now, some violins don't necessarily improve by playing. Most instruments do. It takes away a little bit of the shrillness because of the change in the transfer direction. There is Old Wives' Tale number 2. If you play the violin and I play the violin, there's a difference in the violin sound in time. And there is an answer to that. I'm not sure it's a correct one. Namely, if you play a note on the violin, the shape of stress on the plates is controlled by the way in which the plates move. So, for instance, you can do the experiment. Namely, take a violin and attach a transducer and a pickup to it and put on A and bombard that violin by the note A. And then after play it, if you put on 2,000 hertz instead of the A, you can tell the difference. And that's because it's stressing the plate differently.
I would like to ask if you could comment on what would be the difference in performance of Stradivarius A, B, C, D, E. If you have a whole array of them, what difference is there between one Stradivarius and another one?
Well,
it's hard to answer.
There's only one where all my latest ideas are in it, and that's the Audrey, which I feel is better than the others. The others are the result of experiments, and they don't necessarily satisfy what I would want in the violin. And it shows up in response, shrillness, ringing, high frequency, and ultimate loudness of the instruments. Is that the thing you're asking about?
I was interested to know what is the difference between Stradivarius that we might see in a museum and another one?
Oh, among the Stradivari.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Well, first of all, Stradivari lived a very long life, and he changed instruments at various stages, and they are considered to be 3 stages of Stradivari instruments. The earlier ones, which are very much like his teacher, Niccolò Amati, they're big, they have a high arching. The middle period, which the Audrey is a copy of the middle period, it is an instrument which is narrow. It is still fairly highly arched and a little bit smaller. And the net result of those two is the Amati earlier models are quite sweet and colored in their sound, not necessarily as highly developed. I suspect Stradivari in his life changed things and learned things. So there's that problem. The late period of Strads are wide, longer, and flattened. And that gives it a different plate motion, which is restricted to its physical shape. But the graduations are different, too.
Question over here. I was wondering, has it ever been done, or does it even make sense to take an MRI of a violin?
I'm sorry, too.
To take an MRI.
Oh. I'm trying to think of anything that MRI would measure that. You've got me. I don't know. Well, if you think of an MRI as a means of analysis, you could say, well, make a frequency response curve of the violin. And that is essentially a way to look at the different motions of it. And you can do that, and I spent years at it, and found that it was not very productive, because the response curve has at least 10,000 bumps and curves in it, and it's very difficult to correlate them with what you hear. The better MRI is to have Rosie play it and listen to it.
Let me just say about, am I on? Or yeah, can you hear me? I've been loaned Stradivarius on quite a few concert occasions. And the problem with giving you an evaluation is that some of them have been through a lot of work that's done by adjustment on the inside, and you can't really tell what their potential is. And I suspect that some of them are irretrievably altered, in other words, where you really couldn't bring it back from where it was at. And I don't think I've ever played a Strad that I would say I love to play. And I think it's because they are popular and they go through a tremendous amount of handling. And I've heard them in recordings. In fact, I don't remember what the name of the Strad. John, are you out there that Emerson is playing? What was that called? You don't remember. Very beautiful, high voice to it. But the best instrument I ever heard, and I didn't play it, but I heard it, was, I think, owned by Regis Pasquier, and it was Montagnana, and it was to die for. It was, and I think it's because it wasn't played a lot. I mean, it didn't pass through a lot of people. It wasn't in the mix all the time. That's not to put down Strad. It's just to say they really have taken a tremendous amount of heat. And they will give you a very nice center chord of the sound when you play them, but as far as the personality, that gets diminished in all this handling. You don't really know what that voice is. I don't know if that's useful or not.
We have a question over here. I'm curious to know if you could comment on how what you've spoken about tonight translates to the viola and the cello, or in the bass, I guess, too.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
Yeah, I don't understand. Say it again.
The cello and the viola and the bass, how are they, how does what you've spoken of relate to those instruments?
It's clear that in the violas that I have had a chance to look at and measure crudely, the basic ideas of the breathing mode control, the shrillness control, and the tweeter are all the same, except the magnitude of the thicknesses, which have to be different for different sizes. Is that?
I'm wondering why Stradivari's knowledge didn't pass on to his students to continue the high quality of the violins that are being made, and if for some reason he chose to not have any apprentices, and that's why that his knowledge can't be replicated today from the golden age by making 20 different violins, sort of scientifically, one with a high big this and one with a small that, to see how to create the best violin.
I can't hear this. What's this? Can you?
Well,
do you want me to ask that again?
I didn't quite get.
Do you want
what's
me to ask that again?
Yeah.
Please do. First of all, let me comment on the descendants. Stradivari had a large number of apprentices, and to a large extent, many of them were successful. But for instance, his son never made violins which were comparable to his father. But this was also true of the Bergonzi family. The Bergonzi family, which lived next door to Stradivari physically, the Carlo Bergonzi made instruments which, in many people's evaluation, are comparable to those of Stradivari. They're very much alike in shape and so on. And then the son made also violins, Michelangelo, and the grandson. And the interesting thing is that the grandson lived late enough so that he had visitors from France coming and asking him why his instruments were not as good as his grandfather. And he knew that they were not. There was a whole phenomenon of possible explanations. I don't know how valid they were. Tastes changed, concert halls changed, music changed, occupational armies of Cremona changed, life in general changed, and...
Well, there's another factor, which is quite difficult, and that is we're asked to play loud.
Yes,
and
that's true.
We're in halls that are dead and big, and people want to hear it, and they want to hear a kind of almost like your recording. That's not what the instrument sounds like. That's an artificial realm. And so one of the greatest problems we face as players is to be willing to play, if I came out and played a really good Strad in the general hall, you would say, well, not too sure about this. It's not loud enough. Because we're used to listening to something being done to us. In those days, they were in different acoustics, but also I think the expectation of art was that you came to participate, and you listened in a way that allowed for you to enter into it at an acoustical level that was not dependent upon letting it be done to you. It's a big problem. And it's...
There is a problem. You cannot just take the graduation. Why don't you take the Seraphim and just duplicate those graduations? The problem is you'll not get the same wood, you'll not get the same varnish absorption, you will not get exactly the same shape. And all of these then have to be corrected by subtle changes in the instrument. And I'm convinced that the great violin makers made those adjustments after the instrument was finished.
We have a question here, and after this we'll take one more.
Hi. I was wondering what violins and bows you were playing on and which violin you tweaked at the to show us the difference in sound.
I didn't understand the question. Move it away a little bit. It's too much.
Okay.
We've got so much of you. We don't know what to do with it all.
I'm overwhelming. What types of violins are you playing on in the bows? Like, are the bows French or are all the violins Italian?
You mean what violins are here?
And the bow. And she asked about the bows.
With the bows. The bow is a Picot, which is a very fancy bow. And it has horsehair on it, as I told you before, which is not so.
But the Picot is a very, very highly sought after bow.
And
the bow does affect the acoustics of the violin in a complicated way, which I think now is probably well understood.
Jack, what is this bow? This is Jack's bow, and it's very interesting. It's snakewood, isn't it?
I wish it were.
Oh, you wish it were.
It's been painted to look like
snakewood. Oh, I see.
Snake oil.
Well, it has a nice frog. Well, let's just see what it sounds like, shall we? Well, we'll hear it on Audrey's. How about that? There's no rosin on it.
I wore it out.
Yeah. It really is. It's not bad.
Thinner. A little bit thinner in the sound.
Yeah. Yeah. What a bow can do is amplify the instrument in its resonance. And it gives you that color, the talking part. I mean, that's what it can do. A good bow can go way, way down to pianissimo. And pianissimo is the best. And the hardest. Good question. Yes?
I'm going to cheat.
I have two questions. Is there any difference in the sound quality if two violins were identical except one had a solid back and the other had two parts to the back?
I don't know.
Yes. The advantage of having the back spliced is that it mechanically stabilizes the shape of it for distortion in either forces applied to it or by the warping of the natural properties of the back. It's put together so that the one back tends to go in a different direction than the other. So the putting them together, they retain their shape better. But there's also a difference because it could be that the grains are not exactly parallel and they could be cocked. And that changes the transverse distance of the back.
Is that it? We have.
I think we have time for one more question.
Is it true that all Stradivarius have had alterations on their neck angles?
On the what?
On the neck angles to modernize for modern orchestras. I had heard that older instruments have their necks reset at a different angle.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Okay, so doesn't that imply that the instrument that Stradivarius designed is inherently different from the one that we now play?
Well, clearly the instrument with the neck changed, we call it modernized, is a very different acoustical instrument than the original one, which we call a baroque one. What happens is the neck is lengthened, which changes the string length. So for the same pitch, you must have the tension higher for the increased length. It has the angle changed from being nearly flat in the baroque instrument so that it's inclined, so that the height of the bridge then is different. And the bridge filter system, the bridge itself has a very complex system of masses and springs, which is a filter system, and one of the properties of the bridge is related to its height. But you must remember, just because the angle over the bridge is very different, it doesn't mean that the force transverse, which is the force that drives the box acoustically, that itself is not different.
She's been trying to ask a question for a
I wanted to ask about the different types of wood that the violins were made out of. Are all of the Stradivari made out of the same type of wood or a special type of wood for violin?
You asked what they're made out of?
Yeah. A specific type of wood?
The type of wood, mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, generally, the wood that's chosen almost entirely is hard maple. Hard maple for the back. And although it looks curly that way, the grains run the long way of the back. Incidentally, since the wood is so weak transverse compared to its length, acoustically, the violin is fatter than it is long, acoustically.
Made out of that today a lot? A maple? Is that
I can't usually hear you.
What? Is it, are violins today usually still made out of maple?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Well, yes, modern instruments are all the same type of wood. Spruce for the top, maple for the back. Need not be, but most of them are.
Well, all that applause that we held all night, it's time to give them that applause.
Thank you.